Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 15th chapter. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. The Gospel of the Lord.
The beautiful allegory of the vine and the branches is the most complete expression in all of Scripture of the mystical union between Christ and the person of faith. This unfathomable parable reminds us that this wonderful gospel of God's love is not a measurable thing that we can take into these little hands of ours and say, this is the length of it, this is the width of it, and that is all there is to say about it. The gospel that we profess is not some shallow pond around which we can stroll, for within the good news of the gospel are the surgings of eternity, deep calling to deep. And in this week's gospel lesson, every verse calls us to pause and consider. Jesus says, I am the true vine, you are the branches. It is the vine that draws the sap from the ground, the vine that passes it to the branches, the vine that enables them even to hold on in order that they might get more of the life-giving nourishment needed to thrive. Apart from the vine, the branches are merely withering sticks, soon ready to be tossed into the fire, then a puff of smoke, a crackle of flame, and then nothing at all. Well, this intimate and life-giving connection between the vine and the branches is spoken of in a word that is used 8 times in our gospel lesson, and that word is abide. Abide in me, as I abide in you, Jesus says. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit. And then a few more times as well. But what does it mean to abide? To be really connected to the vine that is Christ? Well, first, the relationship of abiding means that we cannot go it alone in our spiritual lives. In other words, a free-floating spirituality anchored to nothing, connected to nothing, is no spirituality at all. In our Judeo-Christian spirituality, that anchor is God revealed in the person of Jesus, most fully expressed in the cross, for in the death of Christ, we believe we see the very heart of God, broken and bleeding, beating with compassion and love for you, for me, for all people, and for all of creation. But just as God can speak in a Shakespearean sonnet, as well as in the words of Scripture, we would be unwise to limit God's presence in the world to Judeo-Christianity, but rather to seek in our relationships with people of other faiths, and also people of no faith at all, how God might be present in their lives as well. For we would be ignorant to think that God is limited within the parameters of our own spiritual understandings, and that we, as Christians, have a corner on the market when it comes to an understanding of God. And so let's start with the foundational idea, as explained in today's gospel lesson, as to why this connection between Christ and us is so very important. Well, Jesus says it so clearly, so directly, so matter-of-factly. Jesus says, apart from me, you can do nothing. In other words, it's on the basis of our total incapability that Christ enters into this intimate relationship with us. Imagine, we are chosen because of our inability, because of what we are not able to do, rather than what we are able to do. Oh my, how we spend our lives doing so that others will be impressed and think enough of us to accept us. We earn relationships in our culture, and still many of those are tentative. For there are friendships, say, like on social media, where if you post the wrong thing or you offend someone with a different point of view than theirs, with a touch of a button, you can suddenly become unfriended. But then there are more substantial friendships, and how beautiful on those rare occasions when they become unconditional places of acceptance. But most of our friendships, even solid ones, still require some sort of filtering, some sort of verbal editing, so as not to offend and risk the very safety and security of the relationship itself. And so you see, we are constantly experiencing this pressure to have to live up to one another's expectations or risk losing our standing among others. It's exhausting at times, isn't it? But not so with the Christ. First of all, God is not interested in your razzle-dazzle. God looks for just the opposite of what the world would reject as useless and of no good. God is drawn to that sort of thing, finds value in it, and claims persons like that for God's own. There is no fear that when this God comes to us, this God will have a change of mind or a change of heart, or suddenly upon meeting our true self, will take off in the other direction, saying that although God's grace knows no limits, God did not realize that anyone could be so blatantly unworthy of serious consideration. Well, knowing all there is to know about you and about me, not only the very best of who we are, but also the very worst, God does not shrink away. God doesn't hesitate. God is absolutely certain of God's decision to be in relationship with you and in relationship with me, and that relationship is safe and secure and forever, even if we reject God. Furthermore, God is not surprised in those times of our lives when we lose our way, when we make mistakes, even fail, even in those times when we turn away from God, or those moments when we doubt, even reject this thing called faith altogether. With a gentle understanding, God simply reminds us, apart from me, you can do nothing. And rather than scold us, God gently woos us back as a lover would seek after a lost love. And then let's talk about how we get connected to the vine in the first place. Well, if you've ever toured the vineyards of Napa or any other vineyard for that matter, you will have heard of the concept of grafting, where the top of a choice vine is attached to the root of another. Well, not only is this a faster way to grow a new type of grape, because the base of the vine is already mature and ready to produce fruit fairly quickly, but it's how we end up with so many different varietals of wine. The beautiful story of salvation history is a story of a God who will not let us go. And even though we became detached from the Creator through our proclivity to wander away from the divine, even though we are prone to rebellious ways that cause us to turn our backs on life itself, God finds a way to graft us back into the vine again. In our Lutheran understanding, that happens at baptism. For what makes the difference is not what we have, nor even what we do, but who we are, who God has made us to be. Children of God. Just a few verses later, in this same chapter of John, as our gospel lesson, Jesus says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide." In other words, it's not our choosing of God that matters, but God's choosing of us. And that's what makes us connected to God. We are God's choice. We are God's children by adoption. It's a one-way street that flows directly from God's heart to us. I love to tell this story because it's a good story, and I'm sure you've heard me tell it before, but good stories are worth retelling. It's about Carol O'Connor. Remember the guy who played Archie Bunker in the TV series All in the Family? And he said that one day his adopted son in real life came to him very upset because he thought that being adopted meant he really didn't belong in that family. Well, Carol O'Connor said, "When I met your mother, when she met me, we fell in love with each other and chose to adopt each other. When we met you, we fell in love with you and chose to adopt you. Don't you see? Everyone in this family is adopted." You know, when we consider the family of faith, including our own faith community, gathered here at River of Hope, those of you online and those who meet in person, we recognize that when God met us, when God met me, when God met you, God fell in love with us and chose to adopt us. Don't you see? Everyone in this family is adopted. And is that not what we've done with each other? Adopted into our own lives, one another as brothers, sisters, and siblings. In other words, staying connected, abiding, if you will, within the community of faith is the same as staying connected with the one who is central to that community of faith. For we are the body of Christ, connected to Christ. We are connected to each other. And conversely, connected to each other, we are also connected to Christ. Tragically, that message of inclusion, acceptance, and love was not enough to overcome the addiction that Hugh Edward O'Connor had with cocaine. At the end of 16 years of an addictive pattern of being in and out of rehab, Hugh took his own life with a gunshot to the head. You know what the opposite of addiction is? Thinking of Carol O'Connor's son. The opposite of addiction is not sobriety. The opposite of addiction is connection. Connection within the community. It's central to the very ideology and credo of Alcoholics Anonymous. And when it comes to other addictions, strengthening and restoring community bonds may be one antidote, especially for the huge loneliness epidemic that pervades the lives of so many. How might we as a faith community foster deeper connections among people? Who is vulnerable to isolation in our community? And how might we respond to that? Jesus asserts this powerful aspect of connection in his statement, "I am the vine, you are the branches." Connected with Christ and with one another, we live, even thrive, bearing much fruit. Disconnected, we wither and die. We need not be afraid of life. Life is often puzzling. Its ways can be steep and slippery, and the crossroads often very confusing. But I am the vine, Jesus says, and you are the branches. I will give you what you need. Abide in this intimate connection I have with you. Abide in the intimate connection you have with one another. And you will bear much fruit. Amen.